you, God, so much for this night. God, I thank you for worship, Lord, that prepares our hearts, Lord. Lord, to receive, God, I pray that it would be good soil tonight. Lord, as we open up the seals and discover what's coming upon the earth, God, please remind us, Lord, that our time is short. God, that you are coming quickly. And Lord, as we open up Revelation and it reveals Jesus Christ, let us fix our eyes on the author and finisher of our faith. We thank you for this night. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay. Revelation chapter 6. All right, we're going to do a little bit of recap because it's getting a little deep into the book of Revelation. Chapter 6 begins what we call the Great Tribulation. And the guy who was going to hang up my posters is walking out of the service right now. Nah, that's cool. Go to the bathroom, bro. Go ahead. I'll wait for you. I can talk. That's all good. I've got a couple minutes. So we're getting into what we call the tribulation. All right, now I have to be honest with you guys. I know it's not doctrine, but don't hate me. I've been listening to the Left Behind series. I'm at desecration right now, where the Antichrist comes in and desecrates the temple. And I know it's not the best way to study, all right? It's not. But I enjoy it as a good fictional read. So if you look at it like fiction, it works out, right? You read it like Chronicles of Narnia, and it's fine. You know, you don't have to worry about any kind of doctrine. But when it gets to the seals, it gets a little crazy, all right? And we're deep into it, so I want to do a little recap. So Jack, you mind helping me out with a couple of these pictures, man, before Caleb gets back? All right, we're going to start, and I'm going to give Jack a couple of these hair clips, and Jack hung this deadly tripwire, and Caleb can come up and help too. We're going to start with the vision of the Son of Man. Hang it to the left, and then you can kind of feed him what he needs to get from there too, Caleb. We're going to go to the vision. All right, chapter 1 of Revelation, the vision of the glorious man. All right, listen, what is Revelation? We've talked about this before, guys. Start a little closer this way because I don't have so many. Eventually, I'm filling this whole thing up. Isn't that a nice wire up there? And I'm going to leave it up there when the worship band comes up, and it's going to mess them all up. They're going to be trying to praise God to have that wire behind them, not even going to know what to do. All right, so what does Revelation mean? The revealing of what? Of who? Of Jesus, all right? Remember the key to the book. Just like when you read Genesis, when you start in Genesis and you open up Genesis and you read it through the key, you open up the key. The key is everything points to Christ. Isaac and Abraham points to Christ. Jonah, 3 days in the belly of the fish, points to Christ. Same with Revelation, the revealing of Jesus Christ. So open up the book, revealing of the Son of Man. All right, then we go into chapters 2 and 3, the churches. I got 7 pictures for the churches. You guys can bang those out real quick. All right, you remember the corrupt church, the faithful church, the lukewarm church, the hypocritical church, the corrupt ones. Guys, and talking about the different ages and stages and phases that churches go through. And Christ wrote letters to specific churches having specific problems. How many guys believe that Christ writes specific messages to specific believers, the church today? Do you guys believe that? Amen? Right? That Christ has a specific message for specific believers today, that his word is not dead, it's not gone cold or soft, and that it's as relevant as reading a newspaper, and that more relevant than newspaper because it's living, breathing, powerful word of God, amen? So they wrote the letters to the 7 churches, and that, you guys can see that Taylor has done an incredible job with creating our artwork here. And then chapter 4, am I going too fast? You guys got all 7 up there? Chapter 4 was what? All right. That's why we review, amen? Chapter 4 is the throne room of Christ, all right? So we have the throne room in chapter 4, and you can link them, get them close together too, Jack. So John, who's writing the Revelation, has a throne room vision, and he has this vision, and he's transported to the throne room of Jesus Christ. And it says this, he heard a trumpet and a voice saying what? Come up here, you guys are on point. And we're going to tie that to the rapture of the church. We're going to say that when Christ said to John, come up here, we're going to say that this is the rapture. So you had the rapture, the throne room of Christ, and then last week we got into the 4 horsemen of the apocalypse, not the ones from WCW, World Championship Wrestling back in the day. The literal 4 horsemen of the apocalypse. And how, good job, you guys are awesome. Jack, give it up for Jack and Caleb contributing. Hey, look, and it holds weight, too, bro. That's really good. It holds weight. When I get all the timeline up here, this thing's going to have to be like metal braided cord, but it'll work perfectly. All right, so we talked about the 4 horsemen of the apocalypse and how they, that'll work. One more. Yeah. How they rode on the earth. Now, I want to give you guys a little bit of a recap about the 4 horsemen of the apocalypse, okay? So in the beginning of chapter 6, the 4 horsemen ride. Now, here's what the Bible can do. The Bible can give you mountains and valleys. You understand what I mean? Mountains and valleys, not necessarily emotionally or high points and low points in your life, but it can stand you up on a mountaintop and scan you down a line, and it can also bring you down that mountain to make you see linearly what's going on. So here's the deal. The Antichrist we talked about was horse number one, the mockery of Jesus Christ, right? The first horse rides to the earth as Antichrist. How long is he going to be on the earth if we believe he's in the tribulation? 3.5, 7 years, 3.5, he's going to be peaceful, and then he's going to be indwelt by Satan. A little doctrine for you guys. It's not going to be over your head. I know you guys can grasp it, but he's going to be on the earth for 7 years, right? So you're seeing the horse of the Antichrist ride, but it's also making him last 7 years. So the other horse ride, which is the spirit of war, is that a one-time event, or is that the spirit of war is now on the earth? You see where I'm going with this? All right, so the Antichrist rides horse number one, and now he's on the earth. The spirit, the next horse, the red horse, fire red, rides to the earth. And it's not a one-time event that kills Christians. It is now war on the earth. You follow where I'm going with that? The next horse, famine. It's not a one-time event because you pick up in chapter 6 right here, and there's a multitude of witnesses who have been slain for the word of God and their testimony. Meaning this, there's a gap of time. After the four horsemen rode, there's a gap of time where you have slain saints that John sees in heaven. So you have mountains, and then what happens in the middle? Follow me? All right, so it's not to get tripped out on. It's just to say, all right, when the seals open, the four horsemen rides, there's a gap of time, and it's giving you four horsemen are now on the earth. Here's what happens when they're there. All right, the seals, the judgments, the bowls. Revelation can be a little tricky. You guys are a smart group of people, and the word of God is not meant to confound you. Amen? He is not the author of confusion. That's why I don't think God made math. All right? He made the book of Revelation, but I don't think he made math. Amen to those of you that have been there and not done so well like me. So I don't think he was part of that. He's not the author of confusion. It's the revealing of him. The four horsemen are Satan's best attempts to bring evil to the world, right? And we know that when he brought war, Christ brought peace. When the devil brings death, Christ brought life, all right? And no matter what the little devil tries to do, it's never going to be able to compete with what the King of Kings has already done. Amen? Right? That's true. All right? So we know that the King of Kings already wins and that nothing that Satan's going to be able to do can compete. So here we are. We're going to pick back up in chapter 6 of Revelation, verse 9, moving on through our systematic study of the Word of God. Here's where we pick it up. John is seeing now when he opened the fifth seal. We're on the seven seals timeline now. And check your timelines out when you get home. It has all this stuff written down. So it says this, when he opened the fifth seal, I, John, saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, will you judge and avenge your blood on those who dwell on the earth? Verse 11, then a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer. Kind of cool that there's going to be rest in heaven. Select comfort verse right there. Love it. All right. For those of you who don't know what solid comfort is, it's a mattress, resting, little joke, little humor. So rest a little while longer until the both number of your fellow servants and their brethren who will be killed as that war was completed. So John sees this innumerable amount of people sitting up in heaven, and that's why we say the gap of time is there. Here's the cool thing. What do we believe happens before the seals? If we're going to say this is accurate and just hypothetical, what happened in chapter 4? The rapture, it says it right there. Good job, bro. All right. Then we're in the seals, okay, which begins the tribulation. So how do you get from right here where if all the believers, the true believers are gone, to right here where John says an innumerable amount of people who have been slain for their testimony? How do you get there? Anybody have any theses or ideas on how you get there? All right. Nothing me and Google can't handle, right? All right, so here's the theory. This is just Nate's theory right here. What happens if the people that get taken up in the rapture, you believe it exists, what happens if they get taken up in the rapture and all of a sudden the four horsemen of the apocalypse ride and the Antichrist comes onto the scene declaring world power and promising world peace, and all of a sudden every believer who's ever been to a church service realizes that something's true about what Christ they've heard about Christ. And all of a sudden, they see the rapture take place. They see some things change on the earth. They see the Antichrist, and they say, dude, it was true. And how many people do we know that are right there at the cusp of Christianity? And it's something intellectually that stops them from coming to Christ, or something physically, sin-wise, that stops them from coming to Christ, and they know all the facts. They know that Jesus Christ came to the earth, was born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, died on the cross, 3 days later resurrected, is now seated at the right hand of God. They know the facts, right? But something has missed head to heart, right? They've got a head knowledge, and their heart is far off of it. And I think, I believe, this is just personal, that after the rapture takes place, these believers are all going to realize that it was all true, and they're going to start going crazy on the word of God and testimony and just begin sharing their faith. And so this was kind of convicting for me, to be honest with you, because we do live somewhat luxurious lives as believers and somewhat lackadaisical lives as believers. Charlie works with me, and I'm hopefully going to be getting a new job here in the next couple weeks, and I was talking to some of the leaders about what my legacy would be at the current place that I work now and what type of representation of the gospel I would be. Why is it that so many believers need a tragedy type event in order to start bucking up to the plate and swinging for Jesus Christ? Why do I need to have a job change be the reason why I start ministering now? You see where I'm going? All right, so number one in your notes is very personal for Nate Norman. Number one says this: there should always be enough good reasons in the believer's life to speak for and serve the Savior well. Can I get an amen from anybody who believes that? That there should always be enough good reasons for you to find to speak about Jesus Christ. But inevitably, guys, and my frail humanity, I can find many reasons not to speak for Christ. Rejection, social dialect, you know, being just criticized. I can find a handful of reasons not to represent Jesus Christ, but there should be ample reasons in my life that I should serve and speak for Jesus Christ well. Letter A in your notes says this: most of our friends and my friends are seeking reasons not to speak and to serve the Savior. So all of a sudden, the rapture happens, and these guys that have sat in church their whole life get realized that everything was true and start speaking. And it says in chapter 6 that they were slain for the word of God and for their testimony. What is a testimony? What Sean's going to be sharing when Maddie Montgomery comes, right? Testimony. It's simple, okay? And if you haven't written this down, write it down. This is your best witnessing tool. Meaning this, that these people after the rapture were sharing their testimony, and they were getting martyred for it. For their testimony, meaning this: I was on the earth. I was sitting in church. I had all the right answers. Rapture happened and I missed it. They were sharing their testimony, and that's why they were getting killed. Guys, so here's your testimony. This is it, basically. You can write this down. Where you were, all right? Where you were, who you used to be. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. Who you were, and then what happened? What was the world-changing moment in your life? Who did you meet? And I'm telling you, it wasn't one of the members of One Direction, right? It was Jesus Christ who you met that changed your life. And you met him, and then who you are now in Christ. Behold, all things have become new. The old has passed away. It is no longer I who live. I'm crucified with Christ. It is Christ in me. Who you were, who you met, who you are now. That's your testimony. That should be a powerful enough story for someone to see Jesus. Amen? Right? That should be a powerful enough story for our friends and family members to see Jesus through just what's happened to us. Now, again, little Nate Norman being a little bit honest with you guys, 9 times out of 10, what happened to me is my reason for complaint, not reason to proclaim Christ. You know, this happened to me, man. I can't believe it. It's just been so bad. It's been so horrible. And it's my reason for complaining, not necessarily my reason for broadcasting my faith in Jesus Christ. Personal goal for me. All right, Acts chapter 3, Peter had a lot of reason to sulk after Jesus was dead. But in Acts chapter 3, verse 11 and 12, he began a sermon that we know, the day of Pentecost, right? He stood up with boldness. Finally, after Jesus left, when he was still on earth, Peter was running around crazy. I don't know the man. I swear I don't know the man. And then after Jesus died, he's at the day of Pentecost filled with the Holy Spirit, ready to start proclaiming. Now, a cataclysmic event happened in Peter's life that caused that. Would to God he could have done it before the cataclysmic event. Would to God that I could do it before dire things happen and I could speak boldly without having to have a wreck in my life or something like that. Even Jonah, look at Jonah chapter 3. What if Jonah would have gone to Nineveh before the fish, right? What if he'd have just said, all right, I'm going to Nineveh? Of course, we wouldn't have the book of Jonah to read about. But he'd have saved himself some time, wouldn't he? You know, you could have just hopped on a boat and stayed above water and gone to Nineveh. You decided to take the submarine. And spiritual joke, a little Bible joke there for you guys. Letter B says this under point number one: we become instruments of God when we obey his command to go. Is that true? Is that true that you become an instrument of God when you obey his command to go? Just obedience. Just obedience. Even if he's telling you to go to Nineveh, even if he's telling you to open your mouth and share your faith, he's telling you to go. And we become instruments of God when we obey his command to go. So I think these people after the rapture said, dude, it was all true. Let me tell you all about Jesus. Y'all got 7 years, right? And they went on a mission telling people about Jesus. These believers turned on their evangelism gene, and they didn't worry. You know what right here, Seth? You know what I don't think they were worried about right here? Doctrine. I don't think they were all like, you got to have the four spiritual laws nailed down. You need to know what's going to happen if somebody starts speaking in tongues. You need to know how to handle, like, somebody who's wants to come in and be healed, and you try to be prayed to grow a prosthetic leg or something. I don't think that was what they were worried about right then and there. You know what it was? Jesus and him crucified. You know what the apostles preached? Jesus and him crucified. And Paul says this, I've determined to know nothing among you, right, except one thing. Jesus and him crucified. David, one thing have I desired, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord forever, to be a door holder in his house, right? One thing. So I think, guys, just a little side note for us, we get tripped out on a lot of aspects of Christianity, but one thing is needful, right? Jesus Christ and him crucified. That is enough to change a life. Letter C right here, under point number one, don't wait for there to be a tragedy before you begin claiming the truth. Don't wait for there to be a tragedy before you begin claiming the truth. Here's what David says about how and when we should proclaim the truth. Psalm 51:12 says this. You can follow with me on the screen. Restore to me. And this is after he had messed up with Bathsheba too. Interesting chapter. He says, restore to me the joy of salvation and uphold me by your generous spirit. I'm reading a different translation. You can follow New King James up there. Then I will teach transgressors your way and sinners shall be converted to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, God, the God of my salvation, and then my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall flow forth your praise. Basically, David says this. The only motivation he needed to speak up was Christ in his life. A heart that spoke for it, a heart that was healed by Christ, was enough motivation for David to speak. Now, for us that are believers, is that the same thing that resides in each and every one of us? The heart that has redeemed us, that Christ has put inside of us, that reconciles crying out, Abba, Father. That's enough for us to speak right there. Give me the joy of your salvation and I'll speak, all right? So anyway, so these guys, they get out of the rapture. They see what happened. They figured out it was all true and they start speaking. And John sees, as the fifth seal is open, an innumerable amount of people under the throne. Here we go. The sixth seal comes in verse 12. Here we go. I looked, he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair. And remember, Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse, overview. Now you're seeing specific events during the tribulation. You can follow it. All right. And then verse 13, as the stars in heaven fell to the earth, as a fig tree drops its late figs when it's shaken by a wind. Verse 14, and the sky receded like a scroll, and it was rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the king of the earth, the kings of the earth, and the great men, the rich men, the commanders and the mighty men, every slave and every free man, hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks. And in the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne, for the wrath and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the day of his wrath has come, and who is able to bear it? And really a weird event right here where the prominent people, all right, just picture this, spiritual imagination here. Can you imagine the prominent people of the earth afraid of a divine event, all right, and not trying to pin it off on asteroids or meteor showers, but literally saying that it was the wrath of the Lamb and knowing it was, and still not repenting, being face to face with the truth and still not repenting. Here's what I wrote down in my notes. Number two, you can follow this with me right here. Number two, people, our friends, some people you know, spend more time running from God than they do returning to God. Isn't that true? Isn't that true, guys, that, man, so many of our friends spend time, it's more of their time running from God than they do returning to God. These guys are running for their lives, saying, save us from the wrath of the Lamb. Get us out of this situation from the wrath of the Lamb. They knew who it was. They're face to face with God and still not making a decision on Jesus Christ. Now, how many of us, face to face with God's glory and grace and mercy, and still undecided. And here's what's true about the world. They know sometimes, atheism doesn't really have a cause, right? It doesn't really have ammunition. It's just reasons not to go along with God and not to acknowledge the king of the universe. Letter A under point number two says this: the world creates, conjures, and conceives new ways to disobey God rather than obey him. Isn't it interesting that right before he talks about these people running away from God, that he talks about people sharing their testimony and having the word of God? That meaning this, if you have a strong viewpoint on the word of God and are sharing your testimony, I doubt that you're going to be the ones listed as running from God. Does that make sense a little bit? Why the Bible lays itself out that way? That the people who had word of God and a strong testimony were not the ones in the rest of chapter 6 running from God? There's a group who is persecuted for their beliefs, and there's a group that's running from God, asking the mountains to fall on them. What separates the two? The word of God and testimony. That's what separates the two. The view of Jesus Christ separated the two groups right here. Letter B, those whose heart is already with the king need not run when he returns. Y'all ever been like thinking about God like I'm scared to death? You know, and of course we're supposed to fear him. But the group, the two categories right here, one's running to the throne and one's running from the throne. And the difference is Jesus Christ. The difference is, that's it, the difference is Jesus Christ. And put this in 2015. There's a group running to church and there's a group running from church. There's a group that runs from believers and there's a group that runs to believers. You see the difference here? The difference is Jesus Christ. Whatever group these people find themselves in, the difference maker is Jesus Christ. And I'll even take it a step further. Every difference in our life is Jesus Christ. What you run to and what you run from, the difference is Jesus Christ. Convictions, faith, fear, finances, every difference is Jesus Christ. The Bible says in the scriptures has everything that pertains to life and godliness, and the difference is Jesus Christ, the two groups. And you guys know that, right? The two groups, and Jesus Christ is the difference makers. My advice is to align yourselves with Jesus Christ. John chapter 12, verse 46, you can see this on the screen. It says this: I have come as a light into the world, that whoever believes in me should not abide in darkness. Making of the two camps there. John 15:4, here's the desire of God for your life. Here's predestination for the believer right here, if you want to call it that. Abide in me and I in you. That's the will for God's life. Abide in me and I in you. And as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Guys, truthfully, let me be honest with you. I spend a lot of my life trying not to abide in the word of God. It's a hard thing to say from the pulpit. Hard thing to say, but what I choose to have in my life and what I choose to do often takes me from the abiding grace of Jesus Christ. You follow where I'm coming from here? All right? My goal and strive and desire needs to be abiding in Jesus Christ. Abiding. Man, let him abide in my marriage. Let him abide in the ministry. Let him abide in how I work. Let him abide in how I share the gospel. And that way I'll bear fruit, but not spend my time trying not to abide, trying to abide in the world or trying to abide in my flesh. That's not how it's supposed to be. The people at the beginning or the middle of chapter 6 who were slain for the word of God were abiding in that at that point. They were sharing Jesus Christ. They were sharing their faith. That's abiding in him. The people who were running from the Lamb, running from God, they were not abiding him. They were scared to death of him, scared he was going to kill him. Their viewpoint was way off. The difference is abiding in Jesus Christ. All right, can we get through chapter 7? You're like, dude, it's huge. You're never going to make it. Can we make it a little bit through chapter 7? You guys good? Good? Amen? Okay? All right. Taco Bell will be open, I promise you. All right? Chapter 7. All right, here's the deal. Chapter 7, verse 1 says this: after these things, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds, that the wind should not blow. You ever thought about what would happen on the earth if the wind didn't blow? You know how much solar energy we get from wind turbines now? Anyway, interesting little concept here that man thinks he runs the world, and angels are going to hold back this wind. Pretty cool. Then verse 2, I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. Anybody want to take a stab? Seal of the living God? All right, good. I was thinking maybe a cross or something, you know? You know? Jack, did you have something? Maybe. Who knows? He's going to take this seal and he's going to stamp it on some believers' foreheads and create this group called the 144,000. How many guys have had somebody knock on your door claiming to be a member of that group? Y'all know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about? I like talking to it, man. I do. I'm such a glutton for it, man. The last time, my wife knows this too, the last time they came over, Charlie, I was like, where y'all going? I got more to say. Where y'all going? And because I'll take your little books and I'll check them out. And then when you come back, I'm going to have some verses highlighted. I need you to talk to me about this right here. All right. Whatever it is, this guy, you know, if it's the Mormons or Jehovah's Witnesses or whoever else. I saw recently, too, that they're not wearing ties and button-ups anymore. I'm like, you've adapted to society. Now you don't look so, now you're not recognizable. That's a good tactic there. Anyway, so they came over and I was asking them to show me about him carrying up the plates. And I'm like, this is a strong dude right here. This is Arnold Schwarzenegger incarnate right here. This was a strong man. And then to carry him up the hill against the Million Man Army, I mean, this was a bad dude. This was a superhero movie before Marvel got popular. And I was just impressed with the guy. Anyway, and now that you can't look at him because only the elders can see the plates, and they're still in existence, so you just have to trust the burning in your spirit. Anyway, so the 144,000 right here, I always had this dream, of course, listening to Tim LaHaye and Jerry B. Jenkins, that every believer would get this seal of God on their forehead. Maybe it's a cross. Maybe it's like a cool sun tattoo or something like that, or the number 7. I don't know what the seal of God is. The cross would be cool. We know from the way he lined up the tribes that the cross is an actual figure. Yeah, the Illuminati symbol. There it is. Yeah, that's right. The diamond, that's what you're getting on your forehead right there. We're getting the way he lined up the children of Israel, that the cross was actually shaped northwest, south, and east, and he was hung on the cross. Anyway, who knows what it could be, but the bad news is for us, is it's not for us. It's for these 144,000 Jews. Guys, here's what the purpose of this. The tribulation is going to be on earth. It's going to be dark times. He is sending 144,000 witnesses into the world to proclaim his name. All right, they're getting killed. These guys who have the seal of Christ can't get killed. Here's the good news, though. You don't have to worry about the seal of God, because in chapter 4, hopefully, you're going to be gone up, right? And if you're unsure about that, let's take care of it tonight, okay? And I can't guarantee, but the Spirit can make affirmation with your spirit that you're a son or daughter of God, and we cannot worry about the seal of Christ, right? So that'll be later after the tribulation. But here's the deal. These 144,000 get sealed, right? And John sees these people, and it's 12,000 from this tribe, 12,000 from this tribe, 12,000 here, all the 12 tribes of Israel. That's what happens when you try to speed up. Verse 9, after these things, I beheld a great multitude, which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, tongues, standing before the throne of the Lamb. You know what? I think that there might be, it's cool for me to know this too, that heaven doesn't segregate its church congregation. I think that's kind of cool, right? Might be a news flash for some people when they get there, but y'all mean we got the same sanctuary? Anyway, verse 10, and so they're all crying out, this innumerable multitude, with a loud voice saying, salvation belongs to our God, to him who sits on the throne, and unto the Lamb. Verse 11, and all the angels stood around the throne, and the elders of the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, amen, blessing, glory, wisdom, and thanksgiving, and honor, and power, and might be to our God forever and ever. And then the next couple verses, this guy comes up, an angel, and he says, John, who are these people? And verse 14, he says, sir, you know, meaning I don't know, please tell me. And he says, these are those who have come out of the great tribulation, and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they're before the throne of God. And it says that Christ will wipe away every tear from their eye. They shall neither hunger anymore nor thirst anymore, for the King will satisfy their every need. Isn't that a great reassuring thought? Isn't that really, really cool that Christ will satisfy them? For the Lamb, verse 17, who is in the midst of the throne, will shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of waters. And if you take the Bible literally, it means there's going to be some cool exoduses in heaven where Christ is going to be the tour guide. And we're going to see some awesome stuff. And God will wipe away every tear from their eye. Number one about this, you've already been through number one in your notes. This is just a side number one. The bride of Christ is an amazing thing. Some people try to make the bride of Christ out to be like it's small, insignificant. I think we've talked about this with a couple of my brothers. It is a beautiful bride. Christ is going to have a beautiful bride. Now, I saw my sister get married yesterday and saw my old man weep like a little kid. And He didn't even weep that bad. Abel was weeping worse than anybody. It's funny. I took a selfie right before communion, and then when I said that I was gonna, this was the ordination service for you to become pastor of your household and to minister to your wife for the first time, the communion. He goes, a little sound came out like a little sniffle, a little. And I almost said something from the communion table like, bro, it's all good. But he was like, it was just this weird sound. And so we started praying. And as I was praying, all I hear was, he's just sucking it up, man. It's so great. I handed the tissue to my sister Sarah. I should have handed it to him. Anyway, so I don't know where I was going with that. But oh yeah, I was at the wedding. And Sarah was just a beautiful bride. She really was. I mean, I saw her beforehand. And she was absolutely stunning bride and just super beautiful. And it's reminded here that God preparing his son a bride, it's going to be a beautiful bride. So there's people here from every tongue, every tribe, every nation, every race, every species. I love it, right? All under the throne of Jesus Christ. Who is the one person that is worthy to redeem that group of people? And that's Jesus Christ. You know, what can wash away our sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. He, and remember from chapter 5, who was worthy to open the scroll and open the seals? Jesus Christ, the worthy Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, seated high upon the throne. Unto him who sits on the throne be blessing, glory, honor, and praise. There was only one person, one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Amen. Number 3 in your notes. Here it is. When we make him worthy, we are choosing to walk in a testimony of his word rather than this world. When we make him worthy, we are choosing to walk in a testimony of his word rather than this world. Making him worthy. Making Jesus Christ worthy. Because guys, he is worthy, isn't he? He is worthy, is he not? Now listen, I'll preach on this till the cows come home. And if the California people are here, be like, what's that mean? That's a long time, all right? There are so many ways for us as believers to make Christ worthy in our life. And we know this as believers doctrinally, that he's worthy regardless of whether or not our lives ascribe worthiness to him. He's still worthy, right? But our lives as believers should be the attributes of worthiness to his name, like jewels in his crown. And that he could look down and say, that's my boy down there. That's Keith down there. And he is walking in such a way that the world sees Christ's worthiness from a life dedicated to him. Does that make sense? That as believers, you become ambassadors of Jesus Christ when you declare his worthiness through the way that you live. Letter A, making him worthy, love this, should not be a forced choice, but instead a first choice. Could tie your tongue up a little bit, but it makes sense. It should not be a forced, I gotta make Christ worthy. Stink. I was hoping to have an off day. Vacation. Here's one. Going to church and hearing about God because you want to, not because someone made you to. Oh, knapsack. Choosing to get into the Word and open up your Bible because you're hungry, not because it's what you're supposed to do, right? Guilty. Man, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. And sometimes I could try to come up with a doctrinal explanation like, how do I try to make Christ worthy? You know how I make Christ worthy? Get into his word and live it out. And people can see my good deeds and what? Glorify my Father in heaven. Let your light so shine before men that they can see it and glorify God in heaven. Amen? All right. So he says right here that these innumerable people were redeemed by Jesus Christ because he was the only one found worthy enough to redeem. And you know what? That's the testament of our lives. The two camps in the first 2 points, the people that had Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior and the people that were running from Jesus Christ had two stark differences. People that hungered after Christ and people that didn't. My life needs to be an example for other people so that they can look at my life and say, there is a God. Now that is a hard thing for us to do sometimes, for us to be the antonym of atheism with just the way we live, to preach all the time and use words when we need to is a hard way to live. But Bible says, blessed are those that hunger and thirst after righteousness, to make Christ worthy. Letter B, here we go. You can make the king worthy by worshiping him out of obedience rather than obligation. Let me tell you this. The only way that you're able to worship Christ out of obedience is if you have a relationship with him, if the Spirit is in your life, because the Spirit cries, Abba, Father. Let me tell you something. Nate's flesh does not cry, Abba, Father. It cries for some other things. To seek first Nate's kingdom, right? To feed the gratification of my feelings. The Spirit cries, Abba, Father. And unless we have a relationship with him, we cannot worship in obedience. We can worship in obligation, a must, a have to. You can make the king worthy by worshiping out of obedience rather than obligation. Bible says this, you can tell the difference too. Have you ever been around somebody that's bootlegging? You can kind of tell, man. You can tell. And then you've been around somebody who's filled with the Holy Spirit and it's so evident. You're like, dude. And it's like, it's eking from your pores. I mean, it's incredible. Like, you just love Jesus. And I go and I leave the meeting or I leave the time that I spent with him, not even feeling condemned, but just feeling like, man, like it's just, it's permeating through them. The Spirit of God is evident. And that's evidence that they're making Christ worthy. And I can see it. I can totally see it. David says this about this. My soul longs, yes, even faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh cry out for the living God. Sounds like gibberish if you don't know what he's talking about. My soul longs and faints for God. That's the Spirit crying out, making Christ worthy. It comes naturally for those who have the Spirit of Christ. Galatians chapter 6, verse 14, you make Christ worthy. But God forbid that I should boast in anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Paul's saying this, because I've made Jesus Lord, it's easy for me to make him worthy. Is that true? If you've made Jesus Christ Lord, it's easy to make him worthy. Sometimes slipping up, making a mistake, sinful world. But our first choice, our first thought should be to make Christ worthy, to live our life in such a way that we bring him praise and honor and glory to his name, because he's the only worthy one. Amen? Last point, here we go. We make great mention. Jack, would you come and start taking this rope down, just untie it and so the band can play. Make great mention now of Christ's worthiness, and when the time comes, you will already want to. Make great mention of Christ's worthiness, and when the time comes, you will already want to. John in chapter 7 sees the innumerable multitude and sees the one who's worthy enough to make it happen. Guys, that shouldn't take place just for the first time when we get to this group. You follow what I'm saying? The first time that we make Christ worthy should not happen in chapter 7 of Revelation. We should be making Christ worthy right now in our life. Well, Nate, what does that look like? Get into your word. Live it out. My pastor in California used to say this, and I thought it was a little redundant at first. And I said, you know, you could probably come up with a better cliche. There I was in Bible college trying to figure out all the, you know, I had enough ammunition to start a militia. But he would say this, and I just said, you can't end your sermons that way. He said, read the Bible and pray every day. And I'm like, you know, it's just too redundant. It's too redundant. But the more and more and closer I grow to Christ, what else is there that I need to try to do to make Christ worthy? Get into my word and begin praying and letting the Spirit work through my life, right? When I start to walk away from the word of God is when I lose sight of how worthy he is. I lose sight of how good he is. I lose sight of how merciful he is. Guys, you can come on up and I'm going to pray. Our job, our duty as believers is to make Christ worthy with our life. Amen. Let your light so shine before Christ that we see our good deeds and glorify our Father in heaven. The two groups in this chapter, one had Jesus Christ as Lord of their life. They were walking with the word of God and the power of their testimony. And later we're going to learn about a group that overcomes the beast. And it says this, how did they overcome the beast? By the word of God, the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, right? And then the other camp, running for their lives from Christ, running away and getting all the way away from Christ. Because they're afraid of him and they don't understand it. The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. So the two camps, guys, tonight, and I encourage you to evaluate. The Bible says, let a man examine his heart. Let a man see where he's at. Lord, test me and see if I'm in the faith. I want to be in you, Lord. And I want to make my life represent your worthiness. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, I come to you right now and I thank you for this evening, Lord God. I thank you that your word is powerful, living, and breathing, Lord God, and it separates sometimes our intentions and your desires and your goals. Father God, I pray that you would let our lives speak for your name, that you would let our lives represent your glory. You would let our lives be a map for someone else to come and find you. Let our lives speak for you, God. We thank you and praise you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.